Hi, welcome to chapter 6 about the main unit components and the most important thing about the configuration API. So let's jump directly into. I'm here on my Ubuntu 2204 box. Unit is already installed. And we are going to look, what can we do with unit after it was successfully installed? So I'm typing the command key or Windows key on my keyboard and typing terminal. That will open up a pretty nice Ubuntu terminal. Make this a little bit bigger by pressing Control and plus, so you can see that a little bit better. And now what's next? All right, so I will do that step by step, and this applies to all operating systems. So feel free to do this on Red Hat, on CentOS, on WSL with systemd support, or on Ubuntu as well. For macOS, the detection of the services is different, but that will be covered in the installation chapter. Perfect. So blinking cursor, nothing special. So let's see, what can we do? We can type pself and then we can grab for unit. All right, so that does not do anything. So that means unit is not even, it's not running by with its default unit run user. So we can try to use systemctl to start. So sudo system control start unit. It's asking for my password, as this is a root command, retyped password. All right, cool. So it did not error. So using the arrow keys on my keyboard to jump back, and now that looks different. So now we can see we have started unit by systemctl start unit. Now we have three processes. The main process, printing the version 128.0, a controller process, and a router process. I'll explain those three processes in a minute. So this is the service side of things, but what else can we do to check if unit was installed or where is our unit binary located? A couple of ways we can do that is using the which command. Then we can type unit, and here we make sure we use unit D, as D is the name of the binary of unit, unit D. So this prints user sbin unit D. So that means the unit D binary is located inside of user sbin. Another way we can do is using command dash V unit D, and it prints the exact same result. So system control status unit to query the status of the unit process, or start unit to start, stop unit to stop. So again, I can use the arrow keys on my keyboard to jump through the bash history, or control R to search. So I can search for unit, control R, control R, control R to jump back to start. Now let's change this to status. That prints us the status overview of the unit service. To exit this, we press the colon symbol and quit, or control C on your keyboard, whatever is good for you. So to clean the screen, we type clear. All right, so unit is up and running. So we use control R to use the bash history again, type PS to get the process overview. And see, we have three main processes. The main process is the only process that is owned by root, pointing to the binary. We have the controller process that is the main configuration endpoint for us. So that means all the requests for reconfiguration to send the JSON data to the REST endpoint will be the controller process. The router process is the process taking care of all the incoming requests to the listeners we expose with unit. All right, so the most important thing for now is, all right, how can I access the controller endpoint? Is it an IP address? Is it a port? Is it a website? How can I do this? Good question. So let me tell you what. Per default, the controller will be exposed on a Unix socket. Okay, I know that, but how can you how we can make sure that this is a real thing? To do this, we can type unitd dash dash version. And that will print the configuration options of the current unitd binary. And in here, we have this little thing that tells us, cool, the controller listens on a Unix socket that is located in var run control soc. Let's try var run. And there it is, control unit soc. Perfect. All right. So that means we can use a basic HTTP client, sudo curl dash dash Unix socket var run control dash unit dash soc localhost. All right, great. That prints the configuration API. The reason why I have used sudo here is because the control socket is owned by root. That's probably the reason. That gives us the basic configuration of unit, all the API endpoints we probably need. We have certificates to store our HTTPS certificates. We have config that holds our main configuration, listeners, applications. And we have a status object introduced in 128, where we see basic statistics about the current unit instance, about all the connections, requests in total. This is like how many requests did we receive while unit was up and running. Restart unit to make this zero again. And in applications, we see all the applications we will configure in the next lectures. All right. One last thing I want to show you is how to change this from a socket to an IP address endpoint. But please make sure the control endpoint does not have an authentication built in. So make sure on a production system, you do not expose the config endpoint to the public. This is really, really, really important. Don't do this. So to change this, we can either start unit with the control option, define dash dash control, and then specify 127.0.0.1 port 9000. And we can do this by sudo systemctl stop unit to stop it. And then we can use unitd dash dash control 100.0.0.1 port 9000. And now we can use curl on localhost port 9000. Oh, we need to start this with sudo. And now we have the same response. And as the control soc is set to localhost, it is a little bit more secure as it accepts only connections to localhost. But again, make sure you do not expose this port to the public. You can change this in your unit service as well. To do this, we query the service, unit is stopped. And in here, we have the service file. And this is something we can change again. So we do sudo vim, and we can change our service file. And then in here, we have the environments. And in here, the daemon arguments will be passed along to unitd. So in here, we can define the dash dash control option to make unit work from an IP address and port to query the control endpoint, the control API, by using an IP address and port and not an Unix socket. Great. So now we have everything we need to jump in the next lecture and do our Hello World program with NGINX Unit. So keep on rocking and see you in the next chapter.